Good Friday is a solemn day, the solemnest of days, in fact. Today, Christians around the world remember how Jesus Christ, the Lord of the universe, suffered and died on a cross so that we might have life. Even though we are sinners and Christ was perfect, he died so that our death wouldn't be the end. It is, truly, the most remarkable thing to think about, something that will absolutely knock you down with sorrow and then inspire you to get your life together. No doubt Christians around the world are posting solemn and serious reflections on YouTube today, preaching heartfelt words, and I strongly encourage you to take some time today and let it all sink in. It's for this precise reason, however, that I've decided to go in a slightly different direction today, to bring a little levity maybe, to try to approach the event of Good Friday from a slightly different perspective. One second. Come here. Oh, yes. This is Poncho, and isn't he just the cutest, craziest little pup you've ever seen? He is one of the employees' dogs, and oh my gosh, he's full of energy. He is a puppy, and that is lovely. But there will come a day, unfortunately, when Poncho is no more, that just like the rest of us, Poncho's gonna die. And so it lets me wonder, did Christ die for Poncho as well? Will Poncho make it to heaven? Let's investigate. It sort of went better in my mind. Dog hair all over me now. From the very beginning, let's make one thing clear. This question is not among the revealed truths of the Bible or defined in the sacred doctrines of the church. At best, it is what is considered speculative theology, the realm of knowing that may have biblical or doctrinal evidence to support a given position, but about which the church has no definitive answer and probably will never give one. If there are people out there that tell you definitively that your dog will or will not be in heaven someday, they do not know what they're talking about. It is at best speculation, and so it behooves us to walk with a bit of humility. That said, it is an interesting question to ponder that might even reveal a bit about our overall theology, and so I think that we can outline three potential approaches. Many, it would seem, would outright deny the possibility. There is no chance that dogs, insects, trees, or any other creature of God could ever make it to heaven because they have no soul. More precisely, we might make the distinction that St. Thomas Aquinas did between vegetative souls possessed by plants, sensitive souls possessed by animals, and rational souls possessed by humans. For this approach, non-human beings have matter, are alive, and have some sort of a soul animating their being, but their soul is nothing more than stimulus and response. Because it has no rationality, it can never become self-aware, choose to do good, experience the passage of time, or most importantly, freely love God in a way that would make the cross or beatific vision meaningful in any way. If heaven is the eternal bliss of a rational, conscious soul freely choosing to love God and live in God's love, then there is nothing within an animal's nature that could ever experience this. God could theoretically preserve them beyond their natural powers, but there's no reason to believe that this is the case. So, sorry, Poncho. Thomas says, once you're gone, you're gone. But who's really gonna listen to a silly Thomist anyway? Not on this channel. There are many other approaches we can take, including one from one of my favorite authors, C.S. Lewis. For Lewis, there is a distinction between the particular manifestation of an individual, say Poncho or your dog, and the perfect idea or form of dogness that exists outside of matter but in which all dogs participate. It's obviously not an original idea to him, but goes back to the Greek philosopher Plato, although his description varies slightly from the original. In this way, Lewis concludes that while there will be dogness in heaven for us to experience and enjoy the perfection of what it means to be a dog, your particular dog, the material expression that lived during a particular time and place with its own individual characteristics, will not. Once again, sorry, Poncho. While I guess it would be good for us to enjoy dogs in heaven, they just wouldn't be our particular dogs that like us best. So that's kind of unsatisfying. But again, who wants to listen to a silly Protestant anyway? The Chronicles of Narnia have nothing on the Lord of the Rings, so psh, who cares what he thinks? There is still one more approach we can take, and it's the Franciscan one, so you know it's going to be the best. Now, technically speaking, the Franciscans don't have an official stance on this question, and we are by no means a uniform branch of theology, but come on, given St. Francis's view on the world, I'm going to go ahead and claim this one as our own. What might be best described as a sacramental worldview, this third approach focuses on the inherent beauty and goodness of all of creation, that while human beings may have been created in a special likeness of God, maybe the height of creation, all that God created bears the mark of the Creator and has within itself the capacity to reveal God. For this reason, every bit of creation has its own particular way in which it takes part in the life of God. We through our love and rationality, but dogs through their loyalty, trees in their strength, stars in their brightness. There isn't a single thing for each creation, but rather a sense that all that God created pleases God in some way. Unfortunately though, because of the temporality of our world, its fallenness, the mere futility of it all creation eventually decays and dies. There is a limit to every being, and so it yearns for something greater. St. Paul wrote to the Romans, "We know that all creation is groaning in labor pains, even until now. Creation awaits with eager expectation the revelation of the children of God. For creation was made subject to futility, not of its own accord, but because of the one who subjected it, in hope that creation itself would be set free from slavery to corruption and share in the glorious freedom of the children of God." He doesn't just say that humanity groans. It's not just rational souls that are subject to futility and await freedom from corruption. It's creation, all that God has made, all that God abides in, all that points to the splendor of God. For this reason, he includes in his letter to the Colossians the ancient Christological hymn about Christ's origins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him were created all things in heaven and on earth, the visible and the invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he himself might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile all things for him, making peace by the blood of his cross, whether those on earth or those in heaven. And you who once were alienated and hostile in mind because of evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his fleshly body through his death, to present you holy, without blemish, and irreproachable before him, provided that you persevere in faith, firmly grounded, stable, and not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard, which has been preached to every creature under heaven, of which I, Paul, am a minister. Christ came as a human being, yes, but more generally, he came to take on flesh, to become a part of creation, because it is through him and in him that all of creation was made. All things hold together in him, and it was through his taking on flesh and dying on a cross that he sought to reconcile all things in himself. All things. Not just rational souls. Not just those that can fully comprehend the meaning of what the cross means. All things. He created all, he abides in all, and he seeks to gather all to himself in eternity. According to this approach, Pancho was created by Christ, imbued with a special character, and exists for the glory of our God. Because of his obedience to that will, because Pancho never ceased to be who God created him to be, he will one day be reconciled with all of creation in God. Who's a good boy? Yes, you're a good boy. You're a good boy. You're going to heaven. Yes, you are. And while this is great for Pancho and all of our pets at home, it's also an important point for us. Not just because our pets may be with us in heaven, but because it offers us a fundamentally different approach to the world around us and the cross than the first two approaches. You see, if heaven is nothing more than the experience of rational creatures, if redemption is nothing more than a remedy for sin, then that's all the cross will be, a corrective. We sinned, we ruined things, and so God came to fix it. The cross is a rescue mission once everything had been broken, which, when you think about it, makes Christ's sacrificial love, even the incarnation, nothing more than an afterthought. No sin, no crib or no cross. But there's a wider view to be seen here, a fuller expression to be felt. When we view the outside world as created not simply for our benefit on earth, temporary things to hold us over and eventually to be discarded, but rather as having worth in themselves, as participating in the life of God in themselves, then the incarnation, the cross, must take on a greater meaning. It is not only a remedy for sin, but also, maybe even more primarily, the revelation of God as in communion with creation. God didn't just take on human nature, he took on matter, futility, death, For human beings, for God's creatures that denied our nature and acted against his will, the cross is absolutely a remedy for sins. But for the rest of creation, for all that God created that remained faithful to its nature, it is just as meaningfully a participation in their existence, redeeming what is corruptible in them and opening a pathway for all that was created in Christ to remain in him. It is a sense of creation that does not put us at the center, as if everything were created and put here for our sake, and that Christ came to simply be like us, but rather that Christ is the center of everything, and that we take part in a larger, interconnected work of God. Through Christ, we come to be in communion with all that God created. But, as I said before, it's all speculative. Great theologians like Blessed John Duns Scotus, Karl Rahner, and Teilhard de Chardin propose these views on creation, the incarnation, and the cross, and they might be helpful to you. Or they might not. That's cool too. On this Good Friday, we know for sure that Jesus died for our sins, that he offered a pathway of life to humanity, but beyond that, it's all speculation. Maybe he redeemed all of creation. Maybe he would have come regardless of sin. Maybe Jesus came to save dogs specifically, but doesn't really care for cats, because, you know, I don't know. And honestly, I'm guessing that if we are blessed enough to carry our cross to heaven, if we come face to face with Jesus and he welcomes us through the blood of the cross, none of these questions will really matter all that much. God bless you on this most holy of days.